Time for Love Line.
You know, there's gonna be sex, drugs, rock and roll.
The crowd seems to love it.
Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock 92.1 KFMA, Green Valley, Tucson. 92.9 KFMA, Summerhaven.
It's meant for an adult audience.
Love Line may contain sexually oriented content.
Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Love Line.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
Hey, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. Tomorrow night, Richard Branson will be in here. He's the guy from the Virgin Airways. The guy wants to sail the balloon. It's not really a balloon anymore. It's more of a Jiffy Pop container that they're sailing across or around the world, I should say. Tonight, our guests is Ben Stein and Jimmy Kimmel from Win Ben Stein's Money. And before you guys talk, let me just clue some people in. First off, tonight will be a first on Love Line. It'll be the first time a guest comes over and sleeps at my house after the show is through.
Didn't Natasha Pinterest do that?
I thought Jennifer Grey. What? I'm trying to fix my headphones or pans, as we call them in this business. Oh, yes. Yes.
Welcome to Love Line.
This is what I love about Westwood One. Equipment so old you can still beat on it and have it have some effect.
Have it respond.
Jimmy Kimmel is a guy who is completely responsible for getting me into radio, television, and whatever other show business I get involved in. He discovered me about 4 years ago, went way out of his way to get me in. There is nothing in it for him, and I owe him at least 10% of everything that I make as a performer.
And 9 years later, you let me on your show.
That's right.
See the kind of gratitude? Ben did nothing for you, and he's on here with me for the first time.
I did something for you.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, Ben. Ben, speaking of the mic, would you please? Ben and, my hand's out again. All right, you want to pound on that, Drew? Oh, I got to use the hardback.
What is going on in this
dictionary, isn't it?
It's bad over there.
Oh, well, there you are.
This show, Win Ben Stein's Money is by far the best game show on television.
By far.
Do you think that did it? That didn't do it.
I don't know. The match game.
All right.
That's good.
Mike is getting me some new headphones. We'll sort that out. Hey, that worked. Thank you, Mike. Anyway, it's intelligent and it's funny. And
that's we have funny thanks to Jimmy's brilliance.
And it's brilliant thanks to your brilliance, Ben.
No, thanks to Jimmy's brilliance.
Now, last time we saw Jimmy and Ben together on the Love Line program, Ben and Dr. Drew locked antlers a little bit over a topic of sparing the rod.
You know, they edited that all out.
Did they?
It was a TV show.
Really?
Yeah, you guys fighting.
No way. Well, that was the best part.
It was by far the best part.
I don't know about that, but they did edit it out.
You guys weren't speaking, you and Adam.
Well, so you know, we got a little nervous. It's kind of weird to bring you guys in, both our respective like kind of sidekicks that have some sort of credibility.
How weird is it? You guys are best friends, and you each have sidekicks that are boring and wooden like us.
And you guys wind
we're
up getting in a
boring.
Fight right
we
away.
Pam, let's face it, we are.
No, we're not.
No?
No, not at all. We're not. I'm sorry. We're not.
You don't know
I am.
Drew that
I
well.
No, you're not.
Drew
I
isn't
am.
Either.
All right, let's steer the course back back toward the center of the road for a second here. All right, let me just give the plugs out for the show. 7:30 and 11:30 Monday through Friday, Comedy Central. And find out why it's the best game show on TV. Dan.
Thank you.
What's up?
You're 21. What's going on?
What's up?
I'm 21, yeah, and I kind of got the hots for a 16-year-old.
Oh.
And makes me feel like a big perv.
No, not at all.
Not at all?
No, not at all. It doesn't at all. It's not perverted to find a young girl beautiful, and she's not even that young. It would be perverted if she was 4.
No,
but it isn't perverted to find a girl of 16 beautiful. Many girls of 16 are beautiful.
Well, what about acting on it?
What's the law in your state?
We actually kind of hooked up one night. We just kissed her and all, but I mean, there have been times when I really wanted to, like, you know, see what was up, but nothing really happened.
Well, how do you know her?
We work together.
Where do you work?
At a grocery store.
Which one?
Martins on the East Coast.
Which got where? Where are you from?
Hagerstown, Maryland.
I thought you were from Maryland. I'm from Maryland, too. I thought you were from Maryland.
A lot of pedophiles from Maryland.
That is not being a pedophile. No. I think you should find out what the law is first.
Must be bred into me, huh?
There's some law, I think, on this subject.
Right, here's the law. Maryland, 16. Age of consent.
Well, then you're all
really?
Set. I'd say you're all set. You have this written down somewhere?
They do that for the politicians? What kind of a chart? Who has a chart like that?
I want to see this chart. Just a minute.
Wow. Yeah.
Ben, you should laminate that and put it in your wallet. You do a lot of traveling.
Yeah. Ben's moving to Iowa.
Delaware, the age is 12.
Wow. Iowa just says fetus next to it.
Let's see, Idaho, where I actually had a mad crush on my son's babysitter. Well, no, it's 18 there.
Yeah. How old was she?
She was 16.
Ben and Jimmy are looking at is a piece of paper that has all the ages of consent throughout the country that Drew keeps taped on the back of his magic marker board, the one that he uses to write down the call number so I know which buttons to punch here. Dan?
Yeah?
Tell us what she looks like.
Oh, please, Ben.
That's in great detail.
I was wrong. Ben is not boring or wooden.
No. Ben tell is not.
Ben
not
is embarrassing me.
How tall is she?
She's about 5'9", 5'10".
It's really tall.
Yeah.
Oh, hell, it's height. It goes by height.
Is she really? Is she,
imagine when puberty sets in. She's probably 8 feet.
Does she like you?
Yes, she does. She appears to, at least.
What's right. her father's occupation?
I don't know. I don't know.
You don't want to be an FBI agent.
All right, Dan, you have our mixed blessing.
That's great.
Just be careful.
Yeah, my wholehearted blessing.
In general, though, in my experience, Dan, you correct me if this is not correct. The women tend to get the short end of the bargain in these sorts of situations because...
Well, you don't have to insult the guys.
No, it's true. That the women that tend to be going for older men that are out of their peer age usually are doing that because of some stuff they're acting out.
And well, everybody does everything out of some stuff.
That's true. And the men, absolutely. And the men that are digging down into the younger age groups tend to be objectifying of women.
All right.
Well, I don't think that's true, with all due respect. I think there's a lot of evidence that men like younger women, because young women tend to be very pretty. A lot of
but that is an objectification.
If you say appreciating beauty is objectification, then we're in a lot of trouble, because if you're going to say appreciating
What would objectification be, then?
I would say objectification would be if you valued her for something other than her... You could, if you valued her only for her beauty and disregarded every other part of her personality. But it is by no means unlikely that she has a great personality. I know when I was in law school at Yale, same as Hillary Clinton, I had two very close girlfriends, who were 16, and both of them had very lively personalities, and one of them has been my friend ever since, and now that's been 30 years.
But they're both dogs, right?
Yes. No, they're both really cute. One was really cute.
About 21-year-old guys, though, and how they think of women. It tends to be...
All right, but hold on.
How 16-year-old girls think of men?
Hold on. Let me yell at Drew for a second. Is there a 21-year-old male that's not going to objectify any woman he's with, whether she's 33 or 13? Okay, thank you very much. Anna, you don't have to go to Harvard Law to stump Drew.
Why do we not like objectifying women? I mean, the whole society's aim is to objectify women.
Anna? Women aren't too happy about that.
Listen, you two, save it for the McLaughlin group. Anna?
I want to start a show with Ben. Screw you guys.
Feel free. Go use Pharrell's studio, why don't you? Right now, me and Jimmy have the time of our lives in here. Anna?
Hello.
You're 18. Tell us your problem.
Huh?
What's going on?
What's
right
up?
Ahead.
Hello?
I'm deaf.
Hello?
What country are you from, Anna?
I cannot talk that much right now.
Okay, what country are you from? What country are you from?
Why?
Because you have a bit of an accent.
Oh, well.
Hold on a second. I'm going to put Anna on hold and talk to Ben for a second. Here's what you have to learn with this show.
Well, now I'm going to be crazy.
The folks that you have on your show are intelligent people who pass a test. You understand? Yeah. These people are stone confused, and if there was a test that involved tying their shoes, and you had to do it in under 2 hours, they would fail miserably, oftentimes tying them together and then running after that. You cannot ask them any other questions other than the most basic of questions, or they'll be confused and thrown off.
We'll do some reenactments for them as we go.
You'll see how it goes, right? I mean, you can't ask somebody on this show where you're from or where's your ancestry from.
Oh.
They'll say Orange County.
Let's do an enactment.
We do it all the time.
So where are you from?
No, here's the way it starts.
Yeah.
My name is Rommel.
Rommel, that's an interesting name.
Mm-hmm.
Where is that from?
Parents are from Riverside.
No, but I mean the origins of that name.
Origins? Well, their parents are from Cleveland.
But your ancestors, where did they does
Cleveland?
This name reflect where your ancestors came from?
Ohio? Then eventually I have to go, what color are you? And then you break it down and eventually you can get to
what color this person is.
Anna.
Yes.
All right, just please tell us your question.
Okay. It's kind of long.
Oh, good.
Try to make it in about two sentences.
Okay. I kind of lost because it's kind of embarrassing, I want to say it, okay? My stepfather kind of abused me.
Okay.
And I told my mom about it, and she got angry at him, but I'm kind of shaking. Well, we just had a fight.
You and your mom?
Yeah, and she said that it's my problem, and she's not gonna do anything.
Anna, how long ago did this happen?
Right.
Huh?
How old were you when he abused you?
Do I have to say it?
Yes.
Well, he was two times.
How old were you?
I was 16, I think.
That's when it started, when you were 16?
No, it started when I was 13.
13.
All right, let me just give you a quick example of what we're dealing with there. Reenactment.
Okay. How old were you when your stepfather molested you?
I'm embarrassed to say.
How old were you?
It happened two times.
How old were you?
I was 16.
The first time it happened, you were 16?
I was 13. That's how long it takes to get one.
Why are you making fun of
me? I'm just saying. I'm doing this for you, on your behalf, Ben, so you understand how difficult even the simplest questions on this show are.
I know, but this poor girl is obviously suffering
terribly. So, Anna, okay, look.
Well, the thing is that she doesn't care about what happened.
Well, you got to remember something. Your mom married that abusive a-hole.
Yeah.
All right? That's who your mom is.
My mom
married a jackhole. This is in Jimmy's honor here.
When Ben's son writes a book, that's what it's going to be called, by the way.
Well,
but you understand that she is the kind of person, she undoubtedly was abused too when she was younger in some way. Do we know that?
Wait a minute.
Oh, undoubtedly, yes.
Undoubtedly. Undoubtedly is stretching.
And here's the good part. What happened to real dad? Because I'm sure he's no angel.
He was an alcoholic.
He might not be living, so he might be a real angel.
Hello?
Your real dad?
Well, he's not with us. My mom and my dad divorced. And
why?
Because he was very abusive too.
Right.
He beat her up.
Drugs.
He's an addict and beat her up, which is what we predicted.
Beat her up many times.
Right.
He was kind of crazy.
That's the pattern. I mean, that's the pattern. And they don't change. So, your mom went out and found another one that looked a little different. Probably on the outside looked a lot fuzzier than your dad, but turned out to be the same kind of fact, perhaps even a more pernicious predator.
So what does this poor child do? How old are you now?
18.
You just have to get out of the house now. I mean, you're not going to win your mom over because your mom is the nutcase that brought the two abusive men into your life in the first place. And she's living in a lot of denial, and as Drew said, probably was the victim of some abuse when she was younger.
Let me make
that's
a prediction.
Why she's attracted
I'll make
to
a
it.
Prediction. Her dad was an alcoholic.
Yeah.
What?
Yes.
A prediction.
I was right.
She said yes.
Dr. Drew is right.
Yeah.
That's just the pattern. That's
wait, I think we're hearing her mother now.
No, that was Dr. Joy's brother.
Sound clip.
Oh.
Hello?
Oh.
Hello.
So do you think I should get out of the house?
So your mom was abused in some fashion by the alcoholic grandfather. And that's why she goes out and seeks out these abusers in her life. And you need to establish a life of your own. Recognize that you're worthwhile, that you weren't responsible for this, but don't expect your mom to be any source of support.
Well, here's your real goal. Don't get involved with an abusive guy, because that's where all paths lead to in your life
now. That's the cycle.
Yeah. Well, after what happened, after all of this, just don't want to get involved in anything.
No relationships.
That has to do with any guy.
Understandable. Have you thought about getting some treatment for yourself?
What?
Some treatment.
What's that? Treatment?
Treatment? Maybe some therapy or?
No. Because I've been in treatment with a psychologist.
Yeah.
But I told him about this, and he said he's going to report it to the police.
He has to.
And if he does it, then my mom's going to get very angry at me.
Well, but Anna, he has to. This is the reality of what you're dealing with.
And who cares what your mom thinks, by the way, anyway? This is number two guy she's brought into the house to be abusive.
Never mind her getting angry at you. You need to get angry at her.
And you just need to, you're 18, you need to get out of the house.
Where do you live?
Uh-oh. Hold on, I put her on hold. You know, this could take 25 minutes.
Okay, well,
you want to try? Go ahead.
Where do you live?
In California.
Well, why don't you, are you a student? Yes?
My last year.
Well, why don't you get out of the house, get a job, and live quietly somewhere?
Prison. So, if I have to graduate, and then just...
Well, good luck, sweetheart.
Hey, Anna.
Uh-huh?
Do you have a boyfriend right now?
No, I never had one.
Good.
I don't think I have one.
That's good, Anna.
Perfect.
This all isn't your fault. You didn't ask for this, Mom. You didn't ask her to bring this jackhole into your life. Get out of the house. Establish a life of your own. You're worth far greater than any of these people.
Ben thinks it's supposed to be a comedy show.
This is not
worth far more than
show.
Any of these people will ever let you know.
Scott.
Yes.
You're 16.
Yes, sir.
What's your question?
My question is, I'm trying to think if I'm not for sure what I like more.
My girlfriend, or...
Because I bowl with a lot of gay buddies.
Yeah. I could tell right off the bat Scott was a little light in the loafers. So what are you wearing?
What am I wearing?
Yeah.
Just a casual pair of jeans and a T-shirt.
Mm-hmm. What's it say on the T-shirt?
It's just a plain white T-shirt.
Freddie says relax.
Please.
Hey, Scott.
Yeah.
When did you first start realizing? Start realizing you were gay?
About 4 or 5 months ago.
Oh, before that you didn't have any sense that you were homosexual?
I never did could think, you know. It was just something I was missing every time I was with a girl.
Is the behymen still intact?
Yes.
It is?
Yes.
All right.
How old were you when you first had a sexual experience?
12.
What happened?
It was kind of like molest.
Right. With a guy?
Yes.
Yeah. So,
listen, one thing we've learned from this show, gays and
sexually ambiguous.
Gay people that call into this show, people that are bisexual and a handful of lesbians are not just sort of born, they're created in the lab or the basement. Meaning somebody got hold of them when they're a little bit younger, same sex sort of thing, and that sort of colored their world.
I don't know though. I knew kids when they were little kids seemed like they wanted to play Jamie Summers, the $6 million woman, instead of the Bionic Man.
I think there was a tremendous amount of evidence now that this was genetic.
Call into this program always had something happen to them in the past.
But
though.
That's because. But maybe the two are connected. Maybe they happen to be with a guy who is sexually interested in them because they had some leaning.
It's usually around the age of six to eight, and it's usually an adult male. That's sort of the usual thing. Did anything happen before 12, Scott?
Please?
Anything happened before 12 at all? Any touching or anything?
Not really.
Well, tell me what the not really one was.
I'd have to say yeah, but not too far in to an extent or anything.
What happened?
This guy just like took advantage of me because I don't know. He just made everything look so good.
How old were you?
I was 10.
Anything happened before 10?
No, I can't go any lower. No.
So 10 is where it started.
Yes.
All right. So you're unsure of things. You had things sort of. Kids get sort of. I don't know how to describe it, but sort of hyper excitable about sexuality if they're exposed to it before puberty, and it becomes something that they can't contain or focus or create a stable sense of. It's difficult, especially as the hormones turn on. So, I mean, it may be, Scott, that you're homosexual, and it may be that that's something you're struggling with dealing with, because most homosexuals, I would dare say, when they first realize that's their orientation, fight against it.
Ben?
I'm going to try.
What was it like?
Whether or not it's because of some abuse.
I get the joke, that's very funny. This isn't really that funny. All these calls are quite
usually
sad.
Usually people are very
these aren't
frivolous.
Really, these funny calls are all incredibly sad. This reminds me of the book, Miss Lonely Hearts. I mean, there's one heartrending story after another.
Yeah. Oh, that's what's going on.
Yeah, but this is not that sad. I mean, if the guy's gay, he's gay. Enjoy it. Adam and I are striving for homosexuality.
But he doesn't seem to be that happy about it.
Well, it's very, very unusual for homosexuals at that age to be clear and happy about it. But whether or not it was created or born or some combination, it sort of doesn't matter. I mean, the fact is he pretty clearly seems to be having a homosexual orientation. He needs to come to grips with that. He needs to maybe get some support from gay and lesbian youth groups. And as he
well,
gets...
Well, wait, I don't think we've had him yet explicitly say that he's gay. I thought he said he couldn't decide whether he was gay or not.
He can't decide.
But you might say, is true of many famous entertainers in Hollywood, and we don't...
But at 16, it's sort of the routine for...
You want to drop any names?
Humvees, no. Some of them are really, really famous, and they go on. Which do you think you'd like to be if you could choose?
Scott?
Oh, I turned the radio.
If you could choose, which direction would you think your sexuality would go? If you had a choice.
Feminine. I'd go for the feminine. I'm trying.
You're clinging to the heterosexual orientation.
Yes, because I love my girlfriend, Michelle. I really do with all my heart.
Well, then it doesn't sound to me like you're that gay. You have a girlfriend you love with all your heart.
Marry a professional golfer or something.
Ambiguous. He has to be careful. I mean, again, we made a little lot of how maybe what things contributed to Scott's sexual orientation, but just be careful. My basic advice is... try not to get into a lot of, or even any relationships if you can help it, when you're not clear on your orientation, because it will just serve to confuse things. Look at him now. He's involved with somebody emotionally, but in reality has these very intense feelings for men.
Well, do you have intense feelings for men?
He's on hold. Yeah, he likes guys. But it's only because a guy got to him early.
Yeah, but I don't think I've heard him say that he has intense sexual feelings for men.
Well, he says he's interested in guys.
He said something's lacking.
All right, but look at it this way. Look at it this way. Any guy that has some interest in another guy, even fleeting sexually.
Yes, I agree. That's unusual. At least it's unusual in my experience, but I think... He says that's a fleeting interest. He's madly in love with
Scott,
his girlfriend.
Scott, are you into guys?
Not really, no. But why did you call? Please?
Then why did you call?
Because I'm trying to make sure. I just wanted to tell somebody how I feel to see what it
is. All right.
Well, do you find yourself sexually excited by your girlfriend?
Yes, but it...
Well, do you find yourself sexually excited by men?
Yes, but not as much. With them more than my girlfriend is what I'm trying to say.
Oh, you do?
With men more than
you are. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Had to go revisit that.
That's one of the signs.
Yeah, depending on what your girlfriend looks like, that is definitely one of the signs.
You and Jimmy have been working towards homosexuality for so long.
Oh, if only we could be gay.
We would have the greatest life in the world.
You're gay.
Jimmy'd move into the house.
Jimmy is gay. I don't know if Adam is.
Funny, I was thinking quite the contrary.
Jimmy is not gay.
The whole lifestyle is very appealing to me. If I could just shack up with Jimmy,
yeah.
I would be very happy.
Sunday would be football day, unquestioned.
That's right. Monday night's pizza night.
And then, of course, sodomy night is Wednesday.
Yeah. And then there'd be questions like this. Jimmy, have you not been peeing in the sink again? I see urine around the toilet bowl.
What's this I smell?
Oh, what a life we would have, Jimmy.
Yep.
Yeah, would you share hampers? Would it be all in one hamper?
One hampers.
The whole house would be a hamper.
That's right. Wouldn't even have mattresses.
You wouldn't need a washing machine or anything.
No, it'd be great. What a life we would lead.
Oh.
Every night, it'd just be cards and beer.
Who would
clean for you?
What food?
We would have...
We'd nourish each other with love.
A houseboy?
That's right. We would have a houseboy.
That's right. We have a few of them.
With no genitalia. So we know he wouldn't steal.
A eunuch houseboy.
Right.
And so Jimmy wouldn't cheat with him.
Right. Right. Oh, what a life we would lead. What a utopia. You know, it's funny, Jimmy's sleeping over at my house tonight,
and
my girlfriend's sleeping over, and she's there now, theoretically asleep, unless the pool guys come early. And she said, she said, yeah, Jimmy going to sleep over tonight? And I said, yeah, I hope you don't mind the sofa. And she got a little wigged out because she knew I meant it. All right, let me just sell this, and then we'll go to break. We're running late.
You're not jealous, are you, Ben?
Not at all.
Hey, you and Drew can hook up. Run eat.
Yeah.
Start a family of super geniuses with veins in their foreheads. Ronnie,
yeah.
You're 16. How to get a guy's attention without making eye contact because you're blind or he's blind?
No, I'm blind.
Oh, okay. Well, hold on a second.
Okay.
All right. Don't bump into anything. We got to go to break. Stay there. All right. I try to slide a joke in every once in a while. Ben Stein is here. Jimmy Kimmel's here. Win Ben Stein's Money is the name of the show.
I can't stand this. It's so heartbreaking.
We'll be back to break more hearts after this.
Loveline's phone number is 1-800-LOVE-191. Loveline. With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. We'll be right back.
That is true. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Forget about the fax number. Actually, Richard Branson is going to be in here tomorrow night, the mogul from Virgin fame. Ben Stein, Jimmy Kimmel are both here tonight from Win Ben Stein's Money, 7:30 and 11:30, Monday through Friday on Comedy Central. Yes, Drew.
Actually, I'm blanking on the intro person we just had. Pat Boone. We actually talked to him about him busting somebody in the face.
Percodan. He what?
He beat somebody up. Remember that?
When?
As a joke, no. I said to Pat, have you ever kicked any guy's ass? And he said, well, yes. I punched a gentleman once. I said, what happened? You know, his daughter, Debbie Boone, had the You Light Up My Life song, I guess. It was like, you know, top 10 in, I don't know, 1978 or something, and some crazed fan jumped the wall to his compound, got in the front door, got around in through the kitchen, and Pat ended up used profanity, and that's
that's no reason.
Pat draws the line.
Pat draws the line of profanity.
He's actually an incredibly nice guy. Yeah. Really, really nice guy.
Right. I hope so.
One of nature's noblemen. He is.
Does that mean he's hung?
No, I mean, he's a really great guy.
Yeah, he is. And he punched this guy right in the face and then made him like a cup of tea and they sat down and talked about it.
That's right. Oh. Well, he's a very religious guy, too.
Oh, that's what we hear, yeah.
That's how Jesus used to do it. Punch him in the face and heal.
That's right. Now, where were we?
Renee.
Oh, yeah, Renee. You're 16 and you're blind.
Yeah.
How blind?
Very blind. Totally blind.
You were born blind?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Where do you live?
Northern California.
How do you know?
Huh?
What made you like this guy? Did you want to get his attention?
It's not one particular guy. It's guys in general.
Mm-hmm.
How do you get him to notice you? That's what you want to know?
That's
a very good question.
Yeah, it is a good question.
The problem is really that, like, I've never had a boyfriend, and I've never even gone out on a date with a guy. Just to the movies or anything. And
this is an interesting thing because my nephew happens to be dating a blind girl.
Wow.
And he's 29. He's very, very, very smart. He lives in New York. He's an heir like Jimmy. And he is, he was attracted to a blind girl who is in his class in graduate school just because she was extremely smart and articulate.
Right.
And I said, is she like knockout beautiful? And he said, no, but she's just got an incredibly good personality and is really, really interesting and makes a lot of jokes.
Wow.
So he was captivated by her lively personality and the fact she was such a good student, for what that's worth.
She thinks she's dating John John Kennedy, though.
That's right.
But I think there's two interesting observations in that story. One is that I would think, Renee, you need to meet people who are already in your environment, people you share classes with activities and that kind of. And secondly, in a way, she avoids all the trouble that our college get into of initial attraction.
Absolutely.
She doesn't have to deal with that piece.
It's a blessing in disguise because you don't care what the person looks like.
That's right,
you can pick some. Well, I would hope not. You could pick somebody who you really, really were attracted to their personality.
But here's something interesting as well. A lot of people date people not only for themselves but for their peers. You want to be seen with a beautiful girl. You want to be seen with an attractive man. Now, does that matter to you, Ronnie?
No.
It doesn't. Mm. Well, what if all your friends said, boy, this guy looks like Boris Karloff?
I mean,
well, she probably doesn't know Boris Karloff.
They wouldn't. Yeah, exactly.
Sure, if the guy is you know, cute and, you know, fine, whatever, that's just a bonus.
Well, your friend should lie to you anyway.
Yeah.
No, they shouldn't lie. But, you know, if he's fine, sure.
Have you always been blind?
Huh? Yeah.
You're born blind.
Yeah.
Well, so the thing that's kind of interesting is your definition of attractive may have nothing to do with our definition of attractive.
That's right.
It's interesting. She still may have that same thing, though, of attraction that we hear so much about.
Well, what would make a man attractive
right,
to you?
The mom or the dad thing.
I think we could ask if what makes a man attractive to you would give you a clue about how to attract someone else.
Someone who would care about me and, of course, likes the same stuff that I do.
What stuff do you like?
I seem to be a little weird in that category. I sort of don't like the same music as everybody else, and I'm kind of shy, and actually, I've gotten better lately, but... I don't like the same kind of music, basically, and I don't do sports, of course. And,
good.
I'm on the computer a lot, and I'm not a goody-two-shoes, but I do my schoolwork, and I'm sort of into school, but I'm not, like, crazy, you know. But,
I got a question for you, and I know it sounds bizarre, but it's one of the only things I can ever think about whenever I talk to blind people, which is every morning I get up, I look in the mirror, and I spot something, like a little white head on my forehead or some kind of hair sticking out of someplace or something. Or, you know, once in a while you go to the mall and you've been gone for 6-8 hours and you come home and you look in the mirror and you got a big zit or something that no one told you about.
And you skip right past the eyebrows when you're doing this.
Yeah, well, I gotta pluck those every once in a while, too. But the point is if you got, like, and you're 16, so you probably get a zit every once in a while.
Oh, yeah.
Does somebody tell you, hey... No, the other side, or 10 o'clock, you got a white head. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean. My mom tries to help me with that stuff, and I go and get facials sometimes.
You can actually read your pimples, though.
No, but I keep my skin clean and stuff, you know, washing it and all that kind of stuff. You know,
oh,
like,
man. I really think, knowing what I know about the world, that this is a blessing. I really do. It's bizarre as it sounds.
But Nestle has the most absolutely incredibly sweet voice. You have such an incredibly sweet voice. You should really do commercials. You have such a great, great voice.
Oh, well.
Do you know what you look like? Has anybody given you, like, an assessment whether you'd be a 1 to 10?
Yeah. Well, I'm not, like, 1 to 10, but I know basic features. You know, brown hair, brown eyes, stuff
but
like that.
But can you put them in a context with other people's features? I mean, like, can you feel your nose and then feel like Ben's nose and go, oh, man, I dodged a bullet. Can you do something like that?
Well, one thing that I don't do, and they always show this in the movies, and I hate this, but they...
Well, how do you know what they show in the movies?
They show in the movies, they show blind people feeling everybody's faces, and that is so wrong. I don't do that.
You don't do that?
No.
All right.
So, well, I don't go around and feel something like, hey, it's you. Okay, cool. I don't do that. I just...
How about dating a blind guy, or would that be a mistake? Maybe you should date someone who sees so that, you know, they can take you around and stuff.
It's not, that's not one of the top priorities on my list, actually. I mean, if I fall in love with a blind guy, great. If I don't, great, whatever. That's not one of the main things that I'm looking for. I don't really care whether the guy's blind or not, or whether he's in a wheelchair, or whether he's deaf or whatever. The main thing is the personality for me, and the looks are not... I mean, sure, it's a bonus. It's a plus. Great.
Is it?
Huh?
It is a bonus?
Well, yeah, in what sense is it a bonus? Because your friends will say, gosh, Renit, what a cute guy.
Yeah. And then, like, you know, just from my own personal knowledge, like, I mean, let's say I got, you know, I fell in love with this totally ugly guy, you know, and my friends were like, well, he's a really nice guy, but he's totally gross, and, you know, that wouldn't be so nice to hear, but... You know, sure, if he's good looking, well, that's just extra, you know. But that's not part of my party. My friends, they walk down the hall, they see a guy, oh, dude, he's so fine, you know. And then it's like, yeah, but he's a jerk.
Do you go to regular school?
Yeah.
What town do you live in?
Pleasant Hill. I go to College Park High School.
All right, Runny.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if we answered your question, but we're moving on anyway. And
you do have a wonderful voice. You should consider voice work when you get out of school.
Let's put it this way. It's 16. It's tough enough dating. Blind, you're going to be a few years behind the curve. I think that's just something that comes with the territory, but I think it'll settle itself. And I don't think there's really anything we can tell you to necessarily expedite the whole process.
I don't know. She could show up at school, like, with no shirt on and just say, I forgot, I'm blind. That'll attract guys.
Anyway, I think she's very brave and very articulate.
Okay.
Well, she didn't have a choice.
Yeah.
You know, you're blind.
I really think it's a better life. Knowing what I know now.
Absolutely. And the heightened sense of smell, boy, we'd never have a chance with a blind girl.
Ryan.
Oh, let me tell you about Jimmy. Jimmy's the guy who I broke wind into the coffee can with.
Yeah.
This is my greatest triumph as an adult. You know how some people... you know what some people look back on their life? Like, they're on their deathbed, and they think about their marriage, or they think about the birth of their children, or they think about winning some sort of trophy or being elected to some office. When I look back on my adult life, I will think about farting into a Trader Joe's coffee can, whipping it around from my ass straight to Jimmy and asking him to inhale this
smelly coffee beans.
Delicious Colombian roast. And he buried his face right in that can and took a big hoof, and then he put his head up and he had that look like, hey, you got to take this back. And then he realized. And it was the moment when he realized that brought me the most joy. The transition between, hey, this isn't French roast. It was more like,
Colombian.
This is pot roast from last night.
Juan Valdez has been going crazy with the burrito.
Horrible.
This is what goes on.
How excited was I?
I mean, I had to sit through one night.
It was great triumph.
Adam was having excessive gas, so he decided to regale me with his talent of fart lighting, should we call it?
Yes.
God, this is incredible.
He lit like 300 farts that night.
I ate a whole batch of clams before I came over here, hoping to gas you guys all out of the studio, but just wound up getting diarrhea.
Our listeners have heard stories about you.
Yeah, well, thank you. My colon is famous.
Yes, it precedes him. Ryan?
I won't rest until the whole world smells like the inside of my ass.
Ryan.
My motto.
Yes.
You're 14.
Yeah, I believe that I'm manic depressant because I have been going through a couple of weeks ago, I wanted to kill myself really badly. Lately, I've been really happy.
Okay.
Also,
hold on a second, Ryan. We got to go to break. Ben's got to kill himself.
That's right. We got some fart to do.
We'll come back with that.
This guy is calling with a really serious problem.
I know. That's commercials. But we got to come back. Ben will kill himself, and then they'll start a whole new season of Beat Ben Stein's Corpse. Which, still, I'm guessing a lot of our listeners couldn't be. All right. We'll be back.
You have 5 seconds.
Love Line with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. Back in a minute.
One.
Name of this dog, Ben. Please tell everyone.
Lucy.
Yeah, but what is your nickname
for
the dog?
I call her Puppy Whoppy.
Yeah.
Puppy Whoppy.
Nobody's mentioned to you that's really goofy?
No, my son gave her that name.
No.
See, I was calling her Puppy Upper from that famous
Saturday Night Live skit.
Because she's so hyper. It's like she's taken every Dexedrine in West Hollywood.
Drew, is there anything you could prescribe for this dog?
Duke, do you have a narcotics blank?
I'm not on me, but I have a DEA.
Of
course.
You want something?
Just like a pad, if you have one.
It's as fast as a trip to Drew's trunk.
I keep my triplicates. I try not to write triplicates.
You never write them?
No, I don't never write them. I try not to write them. I always regret writing them.
Is triplicates prescriptions?
I practice every day.
Always regret writing?
Drew, explain the triplicate.
Triplicate is a form issued by the Drug Enforcement Agency where you have to, as a physician, you have to register in a very special way to get these specialized prescriptions that allows you to prescribe controlled substances, opiates, like Percocet, Percodan,
mm-hmm.
certain kinds of stimulants, Dexedrine, that sort of thing.
He got me
Dexedrine
a Christmas.
Schedule 3?
What would be, if those drugs weren't Schedule 3,
Percodan,
would it be?
Percodan, yes, but I wouldn't understand why.
It's speed and opiates.
Ritalin.
Yeah.
No, Ritalin isn't.
Ritalin is.
It is a Schedule 3.
I believe it is. I don't even know what that means.
All I know is Drew had his hand up my ass one time.
Oh, that's right.
That,
Adam
Drew?
Acquired that, though, remember. And he brought a tape recorder with him. I want to thank him for that.
Yeah.
And three other guys.
Jimmy had some difficulty with the opening of his penis. I think some of my cramp was stuck in it. Oh, Drew's lost it now. But there was some cloggage in there, and he had to pay a visit to Drew because it was a very serious situation.
Drew said to me, get down here right away. Your kidneys could shut down and you could die.
Drew,
Adam grabs a tape recorder and merrily comes along.
This is good radio. Drew wears many hats and more gloves. It's really his motto. But Drew gave
Adam,
Jimmy a look in it.
And if I remember, Adam took that opportunity to go off at his own problems. Didn't he?
Yeah, Adam had some things he wanted you to look at, but you refused. But I appreciate you probing me.
And what'd you feel in Jimmy's ass?
I can't remember.
Wait, it's some guy is on the line who's suicidal, and you're talking
about...
No,
we're trying to cheer him up. He's suicidal. Well, wait till your penis hole closes up. See how you get suicidal.
Why did that
happen? That's suicide right there.
Why was that? What had happened?
I don't want to talk about it.
But we did cure it. It was cured by putting up graduated hoses up his urethra.
Yeah, down it, actually.
Spikes.
Spikes, large metal. They look like metal chopsticks. And,
is that
and they were freezing cold. Why is that necessary? Do they have to be freezing cold? That's ridiculous. Can't they warm them a little?
Is it a series of them, or is it one that's just graduated?
Well, it's like that. It does get bigger as it goes in, but no, there are varying sizes. So they'll start with the one, and they plunge you. And Drew tried to tell me to stop masturbating.
Oh, Drew, that's very dangerous advice.
I know, it was cruel. I had to think very long and hard about it.
Yeah, you could be sued when he takes out his block 3 days later.
I'm worried about my health, and I'm not willing to go to those extremes.
Yes. Come on. Let's go to Ryan.
What line's he on? Okay. Ryan, you're 14.
Like I said, I think I'm manic depressant.
Whatever you think you are, you are.
Ryan, now listen. You said you have lots of wild mood fluctuations, right?
Yeah.
And how long have you had that for?
I guess it was kind of recent, about maybe a year ago.
Do you do any drugs?
No.
None?
None.
Anything, any abuse or anything like that in your past?
You love asking people about abuse.
It's always there.
Here's a better question. Are either of your parents suffering from
that? That's the next question.
Yeah, my dad is.
Okay, but let's stay with the abuse issue. Was there any abuse or anything like that perpetrated?
When I was about 6 or 7, my older cousin, female cousin, I guess, kind of molested me.
Okay. And have you had any behavioral problems growing up otherwise?
Not anything abnormal.
You've been okay at school and whatnot? And your mom is bipolar, manic depressive?
No, my dad is.
Father, I'm sorry. Well, look, Ryan, Ben is right that bipolar manic depression is definitely increased risk for offspring of people with this disease. You have some abuse in your past that will tend to add to the risk of mood disturbances. At 14, it's very difficult to make a diagnosis of manic depression, but definitely if you are having dangerous... If your mood fluctuations are becoming becoming dangerous, it is extremely important that you get to some health care because they can help you and you needn't suffer like
there's
this.
There's tremendously effective medication
absolutely.
For this. This is one of the most easily medicated problems in modern life.
That is absolutely true.
All right, so Ryan needs to see a specialist.
Well, go see a psychiatrist or just start with your general doctor and see if you can get a referral. But just know that there is something wrong. You are right. And you needn't suffer with this, and you are in harm's way. 17% of people with depression will kill themselves.
Really?
Ben is yelling things as he takes his dog out
of
the room.
That's from the head of psychiatry at Georgetown University, a guy named Thomas Wise.
Don't worry about
him.
He thinks
he
knows everything. Meanwhile, he has people at that macrame for a living,
right, Ryan,
beating him on the game
show. So, Ryan, get some help, all right, pal? You'll be okay. You will be okay. Know that. But you got to get some help in order to get better.
Mike.
Yo.
You're 40.
Yeah, hi, guys.
Hi.
This is such an honor. Well, first of all, to speak to you, Adam.
Thank you.
That is a real honor. And secondly, of course, Drew. And Adam. Ben, Jimmy, love the show. It's my favorite game show.
Thanks. Ben has left the room.
Oh, why did he leave?
I wanted Ben to hear this.
He'll hear about it. Don't worry.
He picked up the dog and just walked out in the middle of the show. Why did he do that?
Why'd he bring a dog? It's a better question.
Okay.
He's smart, but he has no sense. Right.
Ben, we got Mike.
This guy's a fan of
yours. He's 40 and he's a big fan of yours.
God bless you. The reason I brought the dog was that she's a new dog. She chews up everything. She jumps all around the house. She has giant, giant leaps through the house and knocks things over. And my wife said, I can't stand it. The dog's driving me crazy. Bring her with you.
Ooh. Well, he's back.
Okay.
So, Ben, hi.
How are you?
Fine. I love the show.
God bless you,
sir.
So
good. And I play play along, and I've got to tell you, though, like probably 8 or 9 times out of 10, I can beat you, buddy.
Ooh.
What is your last name, Mike?
Atkins.
Where do you live?
Tucson.
Don't come any closer than here.
That's why I'm saying, do you guys do contestant searches ever?
We do a lot of contestant searches, and I think if you really consistently can beat me 8 out of 10 times, then you should just continue enjoying it at home. And don't burst the bubble by coming in on being on the show.
If you go to futility.com on the internet there, you can enter to be a contestant.
Oh, okay.
What is your occupation, Mike?
What's that?
Are you the one who is bipolar?
No.
Are you the, what is your occupation?
Postal worker.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. I suggest you throw it out. Let him win, yeah.
No, but anyway, guys, I just got to say.
Good luck.
The show's great. I love it. It's, you know, it's not a game show that, you know, dumbs down.
No, and it's too hard.
It's funny, and it's smart, and, you know, it's just a great show. I love it.
Thanks, okay. Mike.
Thanks, Mike.
Okay, Adam. Drew, thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye-bye. Well, that was nice.
Yeah.
Very nice.
He's a big fan of the show, and as well he should be. This is the best game show on television.
Well, God bless you.
Although Ben insisted on appearing on every other game show on television as well, even
well,
ones
only,
that are on against
only
ours.
To promote the show. They told me to.
Rhett, have you done Hollywood Squares?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I did.
Mm-hmm. What?
Rhett?
Uh-huh.
You're 18.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, let's see. I had sex with this girl, and that was, like, I'd say about 4 months ago. And now she's pregnant.
Mm-hmm. And your question is?
Can a girl have her period while she, like, says she's pregnant?
Okay.
Do I have time? No. After
That's
the break?
A doctor.
You want to take a break and then get to it?
Sure.
Or can you just want to answer yes or no?
Oh, no, radio drama.
Okay, that's good.
Come on.
This guy Jimmy knows something about radio.
All right,
Rhett, here's what we're going to do.
All right.
We're going to get the popcorn for Ben.
Okay.
Drew's going to go into his trunk and feed something to Ben's dog so it can relax for the first time in its life. And we'll be back with more Ben and more Jimmy and more Loveline after this. Love line. Yeah, I'm glad they started bringing that 1-2-1-2-3 thing back into the beginning of songs. Seems like it's left for a while. Richard Branson, the genius from Virgin Records, is going to be in here tomorrow night. Tonight we have two other geniuses, Ben Stein and Jimmy Kimmel from Win Ben Stein's Money. We're going to take a 10-second top of the hour break, and we'll be right back with more Love Line in 10 seconds.
This is Love Line on Radio Station.
New Rock, KFMA, 92.1 FM, Greenville, Tucson.
It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. The cast, for lack of a better term, of Win Ben Stein's Money, Comedy Central game show, 7:30 and 11:30, Monday through Friday, is here tonight. Jimmy Kimmel and Ben Stein. Both good guys, and Jimmy even better because he got me into show business. He discovered me about 4 years ago when I trained him to box.
That's right.
And he worked me right in. Had nothing to gain from it.
No.
What a gentleman.
Didn't even win the boxing match.
No.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. No, Adam was more concerned about getting into show business about my...
I see. Training you.
What was the nature of the match?
I fight a lot of people, Ben. That's what you don't know about me. I fight on the side.
Is that true?
I fought Jerry Quarry.
Jerry Quarry must be pretty old by now.
Yeah, that's why I fought him. He was actually comatose at the time.
Jimmy was doing a sort of a radio stunt, and I was driving around my pickup truck after teaching a boxing class with a cabinet in the back of it, driving over Laurel Canyon, listening to him on the morning show talk about a boxing match, saying he needed trainers for this boxing match, and I didn't care which opponent, whether it was Jimmy or the opponent I trained, because I didn't know Jimmy at the time. I just wanted to train somebody, and I didn't plan on getting on the radio. I just wanted to check it out. And Although I do remember, and I'll say it again, I think the very first joke I ever made on the radio, and it possibly was my last, too. It was about 4 years ago. I said, they called me up, and they said, how's the training going with Jimmy? Have you guys, have you picked a nickname for him yet? Because all fighters need a good nickname, and Jimmy's of Italian descent. And I said, well, first we toyed around with calling him the Italian Tornado. And then we thought about calling him the Punch and Paisan. But after seeing him work in the ring, we just settled on Jim.
Yeah, a lot of laughter was had at my expense.
But Jimmy got out there, and he fought his heart out for four rounds.
That's great.
And I sent him out for the second round with no mouthpiece. Which was funny. It's kind of funny, about halfway into the round, when you look down in your hand and you go, hey, we got an extra mouthpiece. And then you go,
who
wait
are you
a minute.
Against?
This guy I worked with, we got in a fight. You know, Drew, I should bring this actually to you sometime. Uh-huh. Adam brought me a public access show that he had hosted.
No.
Yes, he brought me a public access show, and that's what impressed me. Because certainly his boxing skills did not.
No, I wanted to prove to him that I was worthy of the radio, so I showed him a home improvement type public access show I did many years ago.
You get that to me, it's going straight onto our
set. Yeah, we got to dig that up, definitely.
I think I may have it somewhere. Maybe I left it with you.
We have a caller.
Yes, Rhett.
You're all business, aren't you, Ben?
Well, I mean, I feel sorry for this guy. He has a pregnant girlfriend. He's concerned.
Rhett. Yeah, that's right, while we relax poetic.
Right. Her water breaks while I'm regaling us with another story about me and Jimmy and the love we found.
Your girlfriend told you she's pregnant with your baby?
No, she's not my girlfriend.
This girl told you she's pregnant.
Well, she didn't tell me. She called my friend, and I went over to my friend's house today, and he told me that's what she said.
And how do you know she's bleeding?
Huh?
You said something about her having a period.
Yeah, because the last time I seen her, she was bleeding like all over the place.
And was this since she claimed to be pregnant?
Yeah, that's what she's claiming to my friend.
So at the time in which you saw her having menstrual flow.
Yeah.
And I'm dying to know how that happened, by the way.
I don't know. That's why I called you.
Well, no. How was he witnessed the flow itself? You said she was bleeding all over.
He witnessed it. Our caller witnessed it.
He said she was bleeding all over the place.
He's obviously having sex with her. I mean,
I wasn't having sex with her at that time that she was on her rag and everything.
Well, giving her an upper GI? How do you know she was bleeding?
Because you could see it.
What do you mean you can see it?
I told you, all our callers are tards on this show. Listen to me, you jackass. Was she bleeding through her skirt? Did you see a big spot? Was it like something from The Exorcist?
Yeah.
And she was just walking around that way.
Yeah.
No. All right. Well, let's assume it's true. Any blood flow in the first trimester of pregnancy, right, that means in the first 3 months, is something the doctor should evaluate immediately.
All right.
Yeah, particularly, obviously, if she's wanting to see the pregnancy through. But even if somebody who's planning to terminate a pregnancy has bleeding and abdominal pain, that can be a sign of a tubal or ectopic pregnancy, and that can be life-threatening within minutes, frankly.
Well, that's what I need to know, because I don't need a kid on the way, you know.
This has nothing to do with needing or not needing a kid. This is...
She's like 13.
Oh! Brad, yeah, that is funny. You're a funny guy.
That's good. Hold on. Let me write that down. I was going to work that into the show.
What state are you in?
Do what?
What state are you in?
What state Arizona? Prison are you in?
Arizona.
No, not yet.
Yeah, not yet. There
well, wait
go.
A second. This is a pretty serious matter. What are you going to do if she is pregnant?
Probably just see it through. I don't know.
He'll do the wrong thing.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is a very important decision. Giant, important one. I'm against abortion myself. I'm sure
I am, too.
What about adoption?
I think, why don't you ever adopt there?
Hold on.
Wait a minute.
Brett's taking a moral stand on abortion. Yeah, banging 13-year-olds is no problem, and then neglecting them is fine.
That's a bad thing, too.
I'm just hoping the baby dies on its own, you know?
Yeah.
See, for one thing, I'm adopted.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Adoption's a good thing.
Yeah.
Our son is adopted. He's an angel.
Plus, I was brought up by a Christian family and everything else like that. I'm like the black sheep of the family.
But adoption is good, though, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is a child. A 13-year-old mom is not prepared to raise. Yeah. You're not prepared to raise, I do.
But many, many people would like to have that baby.
Of course.
Many.
Yeah. Just don't tell them you're related to it.
All right. But
you may have some legal problems here, though.
That's what I just want to know.
Hey, but Rhett, are you following up with this girl? Are you in contact with her?
No, that's why she called my friend, because she thinks I'm trying to hide from her, which I'm not trying to hide from her.
Well, do you have her phone number?
No, I lost that.
Well, why don't you get her phone number from your friend, call her.
He don't know it either.
Well, get her some medical care.
He doesn't know. Do you know where she lives?
Yeah, I know where she lives.
Why don't you go over to her house and say, I'm sorry this has turned out to be this horrible situation. I want to be helpful and supportive and be a man about this and help you through it in any way that I can.
But the thing is, me and her brother don't get along.
Wouldn't it be nice if our listeners responded the way Ben wants them to?
There's always
I would love that.
Well, she's 13 years old, isn't that right, Ray?
I think you're required, you're morally required to go over there and say, if you're really in this situation, I got you into it, I want to be as helpful as I possibly can to you. So what can I do to be helpful to you?
Doesn't the attorney in you at some point go, I didn't do it, I didn't do anything, don't admit to anything? That's what the attorneys have on this show have advised.
Absolutely
like
not.
Good All right, you. But listen, this guy's not Good. Following moral mandates, or he wouldn't be banging around with 13-year-olds
well,
without
but
condoms.
He didn't follow a moral mandate at that point, but now he has a chance to be better. Mm. He has a chance to be a better
I agree
person.
With Ben.
All right, well, listen, give it a try. I'm just saying it's going to be a pretty tall order for a guy like Rhett to go over to a 13-year-old's house and knock on the door. Her big brother, Dad, answers it. And he says, pardon me, I want to talk about reproductive rights with your daughter.
It's a tall order, but it's a moral necessity.
Say it with roses.
I got to take one. Honestly, we've had other attorneys on the show, and I'm just glad to see you take a moral stand and not a strictly legal one, because attorneys that have talked to guys like Rhett on this show have said, oh, don't admit to anything.
Well,
stay
I'm
away.
Not a practicing lawyer. That's one of the reasons why. But thank you.
Raymond. Just a bad lawyer.
Raymond, you're 23.
Hello.
A good person, but a bad lawyer. Is that how it works?
What's going on?
I wanted to get the doctor's assessment. I'm heterosexual, 100% heterosexual.
No, I never use percentage. You got to wonder, right?
Yeah.
I'm not attracted to men in any way, shape, or form.
But
I enjoy anal penetration.
With men?
Huh?
With men?
No. I've got my tools.
Okay. So what's the problem?
And the thing is that lately I've been thinking about actually trying it with a man.
Why? Mm-hmm. If you're not,
well, that knocks down the percentage a little now, doesn't it? At least
if you're not
like
attracted
96.
To men, why would you want to do that with
Hold
him?
On. You said you're 100%. Does it go up to 500%, or what's the ceiling on it?
It's kind of weird because I would be grossed out at the idea of even kissing a man, but mm-hmm. I don't have a problem with penetration, and I wanted to. What does the doctor think about it?
I think
you very attractive.
When you're my basic belief is, and you're a little older than I usually give this advice to, but you sound confused, so I'm going to give it to you. Confusion is not the time to experiment. Sit with these feelings for a while, get more comfortable with them, and if there's some clarity that develops,
sit with them, not on them, is what you're saying.
Did something happen to you down the line that sort of contributed to some of this chaos?
Never. It just basically it's kind of weird because.
You're a little old to be having this kind of confusion, huh?
Hello?
You're a little old to be having this kind of confusion.
I didn't learn how to, quote-unquote, jerk off until I was 17, but I was pleasuring myself anally since I was about 14 or 15 because...
Well, that's natural.
I was naive at the time. I didn't know what sex was. All I knew was that a guy penetrated a girl, and I figured, well, if a girl could enjoy it, I can too. I didn't even know that this is
You have millions of people who agree with you.
I didn't even know that this is what homosexual men did, and ever since I've been 14 or 15, I've been doing this, and I enjoyed it.
Raymond is one of the greatest arguments for cable I've ever heard in my life. This is why my family's going to have cable. I do not want my young son.
Channel was so scrambled, he started putting things in the wrong place.
Right. I want him to get some information about human sexuality.
So you want him to get the Playboy Channel.
Yes. Or Spice. Raymond?
Yes.
Do you have a girlfriend?
Yes.
What if
does
you...
Does she have a penis?
No.
Is there one she can borrow?
No.
Can you coax her into putting something on and penetrating you that way?
I wouldn't want anyone to know about it.
Well, what about the guy who's in your ass?
Well, that would be...
Except him.
Covert.
Low profile.
You wouldn't tell anybody.
Well, maybe the girlfriend would be low profile, too. I mean, if she's your girlfriend, presumably she has some obligation to keep quiet about
she's
it.
She's not going
to
have cards made up after this episode, believe you me.
Raymond, in general, cheating and creating chaos in your relationships is not going to make you feel better.
Well, we got to get to the bottom of this, Raymond, pardon the pun, because and once you start talking about gays, everything's a double entendre is the thing we've learned. When Drew says you have to get a grip on your homosexuality, I would picture a guy doing a chin-up on a giant penis. But, Raymond...
And
well, hold on a second, Raymond. Hold on.
I think he's worth hearing more from.
Raymond, I want to jump in for a second here and say that we do not believe that a 14-year-old just starts putting stuff in his ass willy-nilly.
No, it just started that way. I mean, like I said, once I learned how to actually jerk off, which was when I was about 17, I'll be honest with you, I fell in love with it. But I didn't let go of. I never let go of the penetration.
No, you never let go of that.
I've incorporated it into my.
What do you put up there usually?
Well, they sell things now.
Oh, they do.
Right.
But back in the day.
Back in the day.
You know, because my dad used to tell me stories about being so poor, he had to actually use the end of a mop handle while mom was still using it and stuff like that.
My dad had to walk barefoot to the adult video store.
We couldn't afford your newfangled dildo, son.
Big old wood thing.
We didn't have latex back then.
Oh, like the caveman.
We used to use a sheep's bladder.
Filled with cement.
Stretched over a rock.
That's right. Right. All right. So, wait a minute. Raymond?
Something else you wanted to say.
I know. Raymond, what else did you want to say?
I wanted to say that, okay, most of this, I think about it a lot. I've been thinking about it a lot lately. And when I pleasure myself, it's when I'm watching a porno. And I'll be imagining myself getting, you know, done with a man. And once, it's crazy because once I ejaculate, I just feel like disgusted. Like, how could I even think that?
Mm-hmm. Well, we all feel disgusted after we ejaculate, no matter what we're thinking.
Doesn't matter who's in the room or what's going on.
Desecrated the memory of the Hee-Haw twins again. I got to get clean somehow. Yeah. All right, Raymond, listen to me. Be honest with me. Was there ever an incident involving anything in your rear end at an early age?
Absolutely not. Not at all.
He's very serious. Wow. He's very adamant. Absolutely not.
What about the front end?
What do you mean?
Well, did you ever have an older brother, an uncle, a cousin?
This was like a child abuse show.
It was all done to yourself. But did nothing got you started in that direction?
I would have to say the only thing was sexual deprivation. I've only had sex once, and it's, I guess, the fact that you get so horny that you tried experimenting. I've done basically everything you can imagine to myself. Yeah. Everything.
Yeah, but where's your dad?
He's gone.
What happened to him?
I'm hearing some real aggression in here. That's what I think this is all about. But Dad, before he left, was he sort of physically abusive?
No, I hardly knew the man.
Was there a stepdad?
No.
Well, what you're hearing is masochism. I mean, you're hearing abuse, aggression towards himself.
Right, exactly. And usually kids that are acting out like that had somebody do something to them.
Or else he just has extremely angry feelings that he can only express towards himself.
That's right. That's right.
Did you ever go to camp?
No. I feel like I'm not. It's like this. It's basically a new feeling I've had within the last about 9 months. I feel I'm not physically, emotionally attracted to men. I mean,
but you're intrigued.
I'm intrigued sexually. I want to try it.
Right. But is what you like the humiliation? I mean, you say you feel humiliated and degraded after you've done it, but is that what you're looking for? I mean, that may be what the purpose of the whole exercise is.
Humiliation?
That's what you said.
No, I mean, once I come, I just feel like, how could I think that? You know,
maybe that's the purpose. The purpose is to, in some way, generate humiliation.
Listen, after you orgasm, everyone does that. Before I masturbate, I always say, I'm going to do five. And then when I'm done, I say, I'm never going to masturbate again.
That's it.
That's the difference.
Throw out the porn, clean the house.
It's disgusting.
This is disgusting. I should be ashamed of myself.
But he's talking about really serious.
Raymond.
I don't know if this is a deeply submerged homosexual who is having extraordinary difficulty dealing. But he's having difficulty dealing with his... Emerging sexuality, or a masochist who is in need of acting out in such a way as to humiliate.
All right, quite a choice.
But the two often go together. It's not at all unusual for the two to be.
We've got to move on to another call. I think
we could peanut butter and jam it up your ass. You know,
we can all agree that whatever feelings he's having, he should just go ahead and explore them in a safe way and be honest with yourself, Raymond. He starts off by saying he's 100% heterosexual. He finishes it off by saying he'd like to have objects in his ass that were attached to another man's groin. And if that ain't gay, then I don't know what is.
So just
be honest with yourself, but not necessarily with your family. Ryan.
Yeah.
You're 18.
Yeah.
What's going on?
All right. First, I want to say, Ben, Jimmy, I love your guys' show. It's like one of the few shows my dad and I will watch together.
What is he doing to you while you watch this?
What?
Is he doing anything to you?
No.
Seems to be a pattern going on here tonight.
It's just my dad and I mean, we don't really get along too much when it comes to, like, TV shows and general, like, cultural stuff.
That's nice, because usually it's, like, baseball players that bring people together like that.
Yeah, but now we are like that, Jimmy.
Yeah, I guess so.
So what is your question, sir?
Okay. Now, like, over the past year or so, when I start making out with a girl and stuff, I get an erection as normal. But
you're lucky. From the vantage point of 53, that sounds very lucky.
But after we stop making out and stuff like that, about 10 to 20 minutes later, I feel the need that I've really got to urinate, but I just can't. And also the left side of my scrotum really hurts. If ever I, like, move too quickly or it's jostled, it feels like I've been kicked there.
Can you have a stroke in your sack, Drew?
No, that is a real... I've heard about that problem. I've heard that before. I think I had that when I was that age, too.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, there's different things that can happen. Has this been happening every single time, or is it just a couple times this happened?
It's been happening every single time.
I mean, there is a lot of what's called pelvic congestion that occurs, that area becomes engorged with blood and stimulated and irritated. And lots of different things can happen. Primarily, the prostate gets inflamed. It's considered not good prostate hygiene to delay ejaculation. Adam's been using that one.
Yeah, you were trying to explain that to me, but
yes.
I mean, let's be reasonable here.
I'm just saying, that's the fact. I'm sure the urologist told you the same thing, right?
No, he said nothing of the kind.
That's great.
Just you did.
That's great. And there's a sort of a packaging center for sperm that sits on top of the testy called the epididymis that is immunologically connected with the prostate that can also get easily inflamed. So all that can really get going.
But having to urinate after sex is a natural impulse.
He doesn't. But he is generating a lot of blood flowing around there. And anytime you do a lot of exercise of any kind, you feel like urinating.
Well, but it's more about this pelvic congestion. It changes it. It's actually an irritation of the urethra and the prostate that gives you the sense of needing to urinate. So.
Okay. So I don't have to, like, go see...
No, it's normal. Not unless it keeps persisting, particularly the pain of the testes.
I want to know why you don't have sex with them.
Well, pretty much, like, one of my patterns in trace histories is I usually go out with these girls who are, like, really religious and stuff, so they're into that, no sex before marriage.
Are you really religious?
Not too much. I mean, I believe in part... I mean, I believe that you really shouldn't have sex unless you really love the girl, but I'm not into that no sex before marriage thing.
Well, I guess you know the solution to this problem, then.
Oral sex?
Yeah.
President Clinton has given us all the solution to this problem.
So, Ryan, you have these encounters, but you don't have the orgasm.
No, I don't have sex at all.
So why don't you ask the girls if they could find it in their heart, because it's a medical issue here, to have sex with you?
Tell him God spoke to you and he said you should get a hand job.
Can you write him a prescription?
No.
All right, Ryan.
All right, thanks a lot.
Good luck with the sack.
Ryan. Thanks for the kind words.
All right, let's...
I go right to the doctor. Any problems with that area? Right to him.
Yeah. Jimmy wanted a helicopter to take him into Drew's office, but
right.
We explained, you know, by the time we called the fire department, we'd probably just get him there on the freeway. Sean. Uh-oh. You're 15. Is it normal for a teenage boy to feel some homosexual feelings? Drew, haven't we touched on this enough tonight? Hey, Sean.
Uh-huh.
Hang on for a second, would you?
Okay.
Oh, boy.
All right. Are you speaking through a beer bong?
No.
Okay,
hang on. One of those penis-shaped phones you're talking into?
Beer bong.
Hold on a second. David?
Yeah.
Hold on. Let me yell at Drew. Drew, do we have to get into homosexuality one more time this evening? Didn't we just talk about that for 25 minutes?
Okay.
This guy's been on hold for 9 minutes. This guy's been on hold for 91 minutes, and we got to go right back to the homosexuality thing?
Okay.
He's been on hold for 91 minutes? What is his problem? I think we should at least address it briefly.
David is 17. His current problem is due to an overprotective upbringing.
Yeah, what? Due to overprotective upbringing?
Hold on
what?
A second. I got to yell at Drew again. You know what Drew likes to do? Whenever I chastise him for a call, he likes to go the most boring call after that and then go, see? There you go.
Well, wait a minute. What is the problem? What's the nature of the problem with the overprotective mother? Maybe it's made him into a child molester.
See, it is interesting, and we'll find out.
What is the nature of the problem?
He's gay. Here's Ellie. Here's a girl. Her best friend's pals cheated on somebody with... there's so many abbreviations in there, I can't figure it out. But there's cheating, and it's a girl. Okay, good. That's who we're going to talk to next.
Good.
And then we'll talk to David, and then we'll talk to Sean. All right.
Okay, like, I'm about to take the biggest math test of my life, and this is kind of embarrassing, but when I take tests, I sweat like there's no tomorrow. Anyway, I heard from my friend that Dan Clear Roll-On has this advanced formula that goes on dryer and leaves no messy white junk on your clothes. So I tried it, and she was right. I'm totally dry, and I smell like a normal human being all day long.
Hi, this is Kristen Johnston from Third Rock from the Sun, and you're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Yes, you is. She's a very nice woman, that Kristen Johnston. Ben Stein and Jimmy Kimmel are both here tonight from Win Ben Stein's Money. Ben Stein, of course, is Ben Stein of Win Ben Stein's Money, and Jim Kimmel is the lovable, hilarious host. 7:30 and 11:30 every night, Monday through Friday, on Comedy Central. Ben is out whipping up another batch of popcorn. He should be in here soon. And until he gets in, we'll just hop on the phones. Ellie?
Yes?
So you're 18.
Yes, I am.
Explain your problem.
Okay, we're calling. My friend is here with me. We recently just broke up with our boyfriends because they cheated on us with each other.
The boys?
Boys, yes. And when this happened, we were all in the same room. I was sleeping, and the other girl, she wasn't sleeping, but they thought that she was. And so we were in the room while this happened. I mean, they did this just right.
Oh, your voice is driving me to homosexuality.
Did you know these guys were bisexual?
No, we did not. Not at all.
What were they doing?
They did it all.
They did it all?
Yes.
They had anal sex?
We believe so. We know for a fact that they had oral sex because that's what they told us, but we have reason to believe in the fact that this other girl, my friend, was awake. That's what she perceived. Of course, her eyes were closed, but that's what she perceived.
Yeah, but her nose was open.
Yeah, really. Well, yeah. But yeah, you got to believe that this was not the first time, then, if they did all that stuff.
Right. Well, we both asked them if this had been the first time, and this gets into my question, too. We asked if this was the first time anything like this had ever happened, and they both told us, you know, yes, this is the first time. It was spontaneous. We were curious. It was experimentation. And so we made it very clear to them that we couldn't stay in the relationship, but that...
Well, let me explain what experimentation is. It's when you have some baking soda and you dump it into vinegar and you watch it fizz for 5 minutes before you watch more TV. Sodomizing your friend's boyfriend is beyond experimentation.
And by the way, experimentation is not something people would do typically in the presence of other people, especially not people they're involved with.
Yeah, you
they
really
did
get
this with the girls watching?
That's more of a commitment.
No, she wasn't watching. She had her eyes closed. They thought she was asleep.
Yeah, but how? Come on.
Well, yeah, you get pretty bold after you've done something a lot of times. It's like when you start masturbating, you know, at first it's like you have, you know, the door triple locked in the bathroom, and eventually, you know, you're firing one off on the drive-thru, the jack-in-the-box, you know, yeah. Or a mom in the passenger seat.
Right.
Right, but...
Hey, Ma, look up something in the Thomas Guide, would you? All right.
Wait a second. How old is everybody in this saga?
Well, I'm 18. My friend is 19. My ex-boyfriend, he's 25, and her ex-boyfriend is 19 also.
Did you just wake up the next morning and confront these guys?
She actually, once this was happening, she just threw the covers off of herself and was like, you know, you guys get decent, I'm out of here. And she, you know, they discussed everything and talked, but the terms of the breakup was that since this was an experimentation thing, and this gets to my question, they wanted us to lie for them and not tell anyone what happened, any of our friends or anything, to say that it was like, oh, that they cheated with another girl or it was a mutual thing. And we
this is when you guys decided to call the radio show?
Right. Then we find out that it wasn't experimentation, that they'd done things like this before.
Oh.
So they just blatantly lied to us about that. And we were
what part of the country do you live in?
Milwaukee.
Mm. Yeah.
Bruce. What, are you a student?
I'm not a student, no.
Hey, Ellie?
Yeah?
Well, of course they lied, and of course you would expect guys to lie that engage in this kind of stuff while you're in the room. And why would you expect them to do anything short of lying, by the way? You know what I'm saying?
Were they all
it's
high?
Embarrassing.
Were you high? Were they high?
No.
Wow.
Man, they're gay.
They're gay.
All right, so what is your question for us?
My question is, since we thought we were under the impression that it was experimentation, we were under an agreement that we wouldn't humiliate them, that we wouldn't embarrass them.
I don't think they'd find it humiliating.
Oh, you shouldn't do that anyway.
Listen, Mangala experimented quite a bit.
Yeah. We find out that they're lying. That
I mean, Wiesenthal decided to cut him some slack?
Yeah, I think you stay out. Count your blessings that you're out of their lives. These guys are liars.
And they're not necessarily healthy.
If you feel compelled to tell other people, fine. But otherwise, just stay away from them and count your blessings.
All right, but Ellie, more importantly, what gets you hooked up with this band of idiots anyway? You know what I'm saying? You're going out with a 25-year-old guy who's wearing a vest a little more than he should, which should have been a tip-off.
Dolphin shorts.
And he's getting it on with your best friend's boyfriend. This is total chaos. What brings you into a relationship like this?
Well, there's some chaos in my past.
Like what?
Her dad
what?
Had sex
you
with her stepdad.
You want to gamble?
We on what?
Yeah, all right, let's
you
do that.
Gamble.
All right, hold on a second there, Ellie. Ben, do you have a dollar on you?
Yeah, I'll give you a dollar.
Oh, we're going to gamble?
Yes.
What is the gamble?
Well, what we do is we gamble on Ellie's past.
Okay, I'll bet on it.
And
I need a dollar.
Here's the deal.
Okay.
Basically, what we try to do is, as I'd asked a few moments ago, why would Ellie get involved with people like this?
Mm-hmm.
People, they don't really do this kind of stuff out of the blue. People call in and say it was out of the blue, but we know, I mean, we've all sized this guy up. He's 25. He's sodomizing his buddy while Ellie's asleep in the same room.
He's a crazy person.
There's something up with Ellie for being attracted to this guy in the first place. Now, what created that and what happened
to
her in the past?
Know.
Oh, yes, we will.
Well, we'll know what happened to her in the past, but we won't know what the effect of it on her was.
Well, we know what the effect is. She gets hooked up with guys that are sort of marginal and slightly abusive.
Dating Siegfried and Roy.
That is assuming that whatever she tells us is the cause.
Right, but let's just make that assumption. Okay, okay. It's a dollar for Christ's sake.
Drew, I don't have another dollar for you.
No.
Ben, can you reach into that wallet, please?
I'll lend you a dollar.
Yeah. Let's let Drew go first. Drew, I'll cover
you. I'm now lending Drew a dollar.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
I have to go first?
Yeah, you go first. I have a good bet.
I'm voting for total chaos in the family system with, like, dad was like a major league drug addict that left a lot of crazy people in the home.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe somebody got to her around the age of 8.
Sexual?
Maybe, but not parents, but the parents creating this chaotic home environment.
All right, so someone outside the family,
and
neighbor, gardener.
Dad particularly is a drug addict, full-fledged.
Okay. Ben?
I'm guessing she's a Democrat.
That's his bet.
All right.
Jimmy?
I'm going to go with Rape by Andy Griffith.
Could you be more specific?
No, I'm sorry, I can't. I'm going to go with stepdad, abusive, two stepdads abusive.
Ooh,
if she, if it,
very
she
good.
She says it was because she was a Democrat. I get the whole stew.
Right. Absolutely.
Okay.
A little less than your usual kitty, but it'll do. I'm going with dad stepped out on mom a couple of times. A few affairs.
Dad cheated on mom?
With a man?
No. Ooh, just dad.
Dad cheated on mom with a man?
Drew. No, just dad. Dad did some cheating.
Okay.
I'm sure they're broken up and all that, but that may have been what broke, the, them up. Mm-hmm. Ellie?
Yes?
Although she said we should gamble on them, which means there's probably some overt sexual abuse. But okay, tell us about your past.
Well, both my parents are drug addicts.
Oh, oh my God, who bet on that?
Drew.
Good work, Dr. Drew.
Good job.
That's great news.
Both my parents are drug addicts, alcoholics, very abusive father. More like emotional abuse than physical abuse. And a little bit of that, too.
The stepdads got to you, two of them?
No stepdads.
What about your parents' friends?
Parents' friends? They were drug addicts, too.
Did they ever do anything to you?
No.
Were they hippies, or were they, like, other kinds of drug addicts?
Very conservative, very, you know...
Republican?
Professional cocaine addicts.
Well, what was... That was their drug? Was cocaine?
Yeah, cocaine and then later crack.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And did you...
The whole time that this was... I knew it was going on for years and years and years, and they, too, just blatantly lied to me about it. I mean...
Did your dad ever cheat on your mom?
No. Not to my knowledge.
What was it like growing up in a family where the parents were crack addicts?
Terrible.
I can't even imagine.
Well, I basically raised myself.
That's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
And what is your party affiliation?
I lean a little more towards the right.
Ooh, Ben fails too. Looks like Drew gets the whole.
Why don't you get involved with some adult children alcoholics or Al-Anon groups? Because LA...
I went to a group like that once, but it was kind of weird because it was all a bunch of adults, like women complaining about their pot smoking husbands.
No, I just like, that was an Al-Anon group, right?
Yeah, they were like, my husband smokes too much pot, I hate it. And okay. I'm like, you know, listen to me, I have these, like, legitimate problems.
I know,
and
he was
just real,
try it, maybe adult children alcoholics, and you'll find people that grew up in the similar kinds of chaos. And if you don't like one meeting, try another one. You eventually find a meeting you like and get a sponsor and work some steps and take that opportunity to really make some change. Because from now on, without some real growth, you're going to choose people that are going to make you unhappy.
Okay.
This is, by the way, if I may say so, a heart-rending story.
Man, it sounds like a great sitcom.
Yeah. You know? Well, in ways, too, dealing with this is hard for me because I'm not feeling any of the emotions of it because of all the coping mechanisms and emotional walls that
that's
I put
right.
up to deal
that's
with my
right.
Well, it sounds like you
that's
already right. have had some measure of therapy to even know this jargon.
You know how much smarter she sounds now than when she first called?
She sounds very,
goes,
very smart.
My girlfriend and I were laying in bed and... Then
well, it's an interesting thing. Our callers want us to buy into a certain version of what they're trying to tell us, and we sort of crack that, and then they get real, and then
I think they want us to get and buy into a certain version of who they are.
Right, right.
So, what is your occupation, may I ask?
My occupation, I'm an apprenticing hairstylist.
And what was your father? What were your father and mother's occupations?
My dad was vice president of a company, and my mom was a manager of a company of advertising, and they both were fired due to their addictions.
Was this boyfriend of yours a hairstylist?
No.
Okay.
He's a molecular biologist.
You're mm-hmm. kidding.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's he's hard at work splitting the anus. Many years in the lab.
God. These are such sad stories.
Oh, yes. That's all very sad.
Yeah.
It's all common.
All right. So, Ellie, get into that. Let's just hop over to David here. We'll sell this before we go to break. David's 17. It's been on hold 108 minutes and 54 seconds.
David, you're an incredibly nice guy to stay on hold so long.
Or okay.
Pathetic.
You have you had an overprotective upbringing?
Yeah, I guess so, if you want to call that. Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
Mom knows you're up this late?
Yeah, she does, actually.
All right, David. Ben, I'm guessing, Ben, did you have a overprotective upbringing?
Oh, incredibly overprotective.
And I know Jimmy's mom's a little over-domineering. She busted me for smoking pot in the parking lot at Jimmy's party.
Oh,
and I freaked
like
out.
That.
I almost
exactly
ate the
problem.
I almost ate the bong. And then I thought, wait, I'm 34 years old. And then they said, do you mind coming up and saying a few words about Jimmy? And I was like, okay, could I just exhale, please, before I go out there?
Was this the party I was at?
Yeah.
The dirty song?
Yes, the greatest party ever.
Oh, God.
All right, we're going to take ourselves a little break. Jimmy Kimmel and Ben Stein are both here from Win Ben Stein's
Money. What about
money.
His problem with the overprotective upbringing?
We will address that after this.
Loveline will be right back.
Hi, this is Suzanne Somers, and you're listening to Loveline with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla, so don't go away.
Yes, you are. Forget about the phone number. Ben Stein and Jimmy Kimmel are both here from Win Ben Stein's Money, the best game show on television. Comedy Central, 7:30 and 11:30, Monday through Friday. Tomorrow night, Richard Branson will be in here. He is the sort of genius explorer entrepreneur who's behind the whole Virgin phenomenon. And Jimmy just reminded me during the commercial that I did a Virgin Cola commercial for his company. So I don't know if he's aware of that or not. But I got paid, not that much. And so far, I've never seen it, although people have told me they've heard it on the radio and seen it on TV, although I've never heard it on the radio, nor have I seen it on television.
Wait, here's a great question.
Jerry Springer will be in here on Wednesday, and until then...
The Space Ghost on Thursday.
Oh, yes, true. Let's not shoot our wad this early in the week. David.
Yeah, how you guys doing?
All right, so your parents are very overprotective.
Yep, that's right.
And give us an example of that.
Well, it's more my mom than my dad, I guess you could say. My mom does... in my mom's mind, I've never gone out on a date with a girl. She doesn't tell me that girls call. What else? I'm almost 18 and I don't have a car. Things like that, I guess you could say.
What are your current problems? You said that there's something happening now that you want to blame on the overprotective parent.
Well, what I think from listening to you guys, because you guys do give out a lot of good information out to everybody, is I do smoke a lot of pot, a lot. And
does your mother know you smoke the pot?
She knew in, I think it was April. I told her in April, and they made a big deal out of it. I lied. I said that I wasn't going to do it anymore just to, so they wouldn't bug me about it anymore, but I kept on doing it.
Why'd you tell her?
Why did I tell her? Because a cousin that's a police officer, he bugged me about it so much and was trying to blackmail me for it. I just told her. I just straight out told
that's
them all.
That's good. Your cousin, the cop.
Thank God. My cousins are all drug dealers, so I dodged that bullet.
Your mother doesn't sound that overprotective if she knows
there's,
you're smoking
you know what?
Dope.
With friends that I have, like, I can't have any of my friends. All my guy friends are either gang members. Or in my mom's mind, they're all either gang members or things like that. Nobody's allowed in my house.
Yeah. My mother's kind of like this, too, actually. I mean, I'm not kidding. When I first, got involved with radio, you know, she asks probing, kind of loaded questions. What are those guys on at that radio station? You know, that kind of thing? Like, I'm going to slip and go, heroin. that's how kind of how my mother is. There's a lot of mockery if there was some girl she sensed I liked. I think it's some kind of a defense mechanism against not wanting you to leave the house.
But wait a second. So how is this hurting you? You're high all the time.
I'm thinking, well, see, in the screener or whatever, the lady that I talked to first, she asked me if anything really bad happened to me when I was younger. And all I can remember to my extent is... that cousin I was telling you that's a cop, when I was about 6 years old, I kissed him. Mm. That was it.
How is he trying to blackmail you?
This is not about that.
It's not about good.
Is he the cop from the Village People?
Did you ever have any preoccupations with food? Or dieting? Did you try to diet a lot when you were like 13, 14?
You know what? When I was 16, I looked at the sides of my stomach and I said, I'm a little too big.
How in God's name did you know that, Drew?
Because the intrusive parent, particularly mom on son, mom on daughter, tends to be the setup for an eating disorder. And although eating disorder is relatively rare in males, this is the perfect setup for that. And this is...
What about this?
Oh, my God.
What about this?
That's giving me an eating disorder.
It's my stomach. There's no eating disorder there.
But here's the way I would put this together. If we were gambling,
yeah.
I would put this together as... Mom probably had an alcoholic father, and Dad was sort of out of control and chaotic, and she wanted to be sure that nothing like that ever happened to her son, and particularly that he never used substances. I'm sure that's in the back of her mind motivating her. What she does is finally drive this guy to doing it, and they end up enabling the substance use is the point. They create it and then enable it.
Well, wait a second, Drew.
Yeah.
Surely there are all kinds of reasons people use marijuana besides the ones you're talking about. I mean,
well, pretty much only alcoholics develop a daily use of marijuana. It's the only time you ever see that.
Well, he's 18. Do you think he's an alcoholic?
Well, the biology of alcohol, that gene for...
Hey, David.
Yes.
Do you use it daily?
Pot? Yeah.
More than, like, do you use it the whole day long?
Like, maybe four times a day, three times
a day. Oh, that's not bad.
And, David, Ben, here's the interesting thing. Is it... When you ask guys like David what they experience...
Sure, don't you feel foolish for thinking you had a problem?
Yeah.
When you ask guys like David what they experienced the first time they smoked pot... Do you remember the first time you smoked pot, David?
Yes, I did.
And what was that like? What did you think of the drug?
Like you said, you know, I really liked it. I thought it was a really cool...
Yeah, but this... Wait a second. You're going, Dr. Drew, for the idea that there's some receptor in his brain, some uptake part of his brain,
yes,
that is particularly receptive to the tetrahydrocannabinol. But there are many people who have that super sensitivity to one drug and don't have it to another. For example, I myself love certain prescription drugs and can't stand alcohol.
Well, that's a Jewish thing.
That's a Jewish thing. The only time you see that is in ethnic Jews. The other,
I don't
otherwise,
think that's true at all.
I'm an addictionologist. I run a program.
Do you think that is true?
I can only tell you my clinical experience, which I've seen it now thousands of times.
It's really just an attorney's, but you got to do the math.
Only Jews like prescription medicine?
No. It's one of the only circumstances in which you see opiate and stimulant dependency commonly without alcoholism. They have no alcoholism amongst Jews. It's very rare in Jews. But it's very rare. But in opiate addiction and stimulant dependency is very common. And I've yet to treat an opiate addict of Jewish ethnic descent who had any alcoholism. And I've yet to treat an opiate addict of non-ethnic Jewish descent who wasn't an alcoholic.
That's incredible.
And he guessed the food thing,
that
too.
That is incredible.
But maybe...
See that? If true, that's unbelievably
incredible. It's true in terms of my clinical experience. Whether or not it's an absolute fact...
Drew has a theory, though, with the price of beer coming down these days that may change in the coming years. Be honest, Drew. You said last show.
I did say that last night, but...
All right.
Go ahead. So David is opiate, as marijuana.
David just needs to move out of the house.
That's right. David is 17.
Yeah, if he moved out of the house, he'd be able to get a really lot of dope.
Yeah, sure.
David needs to get an MA and get away from mom, because mom is going to really fuel
his
He's
already got an MA. He's trying to get away from her.
What's an MA?
Marijuana Anonymous. MA.
Oh. All right, Drew, can we
have that?
Can we?
Oh, yeah. It's a great program, too. MA is very, very solid.
People remember to show up.
Marijuana is supposed to be very, very addictive.
For some, a very tiny subset of alcoholics.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. You want to jump into one, or should we just blow through a few? Let's do that. I'm going to talk to Sean, who's been on hold for a while now. Sean?
Yeah?
15, is it normal? Oh, we remember Sean's voice. For a teenage boy to feel some homosexual feelings.
Uh-huh.
It's normal to be a little bit ambivalent.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't have to act on it.
Okay. I was first gonna say, Ben.
Yes.
Sir. I like watch your show all the time. On Comedy Central.
Is he the one you're having the feelings about?
Hmm.
Never mind.
No, I mean, I just wanted to say that.
I appreciate it. So does Jimmy. Couldn't do it without Jimmy.
Hmm.
Sean.
Uh-huh.
It's okay to have some feelings, but if you're a little bit confused, don't experiment. It'll make you more confused.
And
that's what we run into.
All this is okay and normal, and you'll figure it out as you get older, but right. Don't act out now.
Don't take a job as like a magician's assistant or anything like that.
Eric.
Yeah.
You're 38.
Yeah.
Does sexual abuse necessarily have to include actual touching?
Mm-hmm.
Superman can abuse without touching. Other than that, you have to do it. You have to cop a feel.
But there's some law on this that I think sexual abuse can be sexual abuse without touching.
Well, there's harassment.
No, I think there could be sex abuse without touching.
Like how? Remember Scott Baio in Zapped?
Yeah,
lifting girls' skirts up using telepathy?
Exposing kids to, explicit sexual material.
I
think that those are all legally considered sex abuse.
I would agree with that.
It's possible.
Why? What are you looking to do?
The situation is that I have not had sex at my age, and I'm feeling quite depressed. And
where do you live, my friend?
Near Seattle.
There are many, many, many prostitutes. Why don't you just go to a prostitute? Why is that funny?
The lack of emotional commitment, I think, and the fact that she would be with anybody who has a...
Are you looking for a relationship?
Yeah.
Oh, forget that.
Oh, how old are you? If there's an ATM nearby, you can keep it going.
How old are you?
38.
Oh, that's nothing. I know hundreds of guys that are in their late 30s that haven't had sex.
That's right. He can count them on his own penis. Eric, if you want to have a relationship, have a relationship.
If you want to have a relationship, get a dog.
Yeah.
What? The problem is with that is I feel ashamed and afraid of being humiliated.
The dog will never make you feel ashamed.
Here's the deal. Everybody in a relationship gets humiliated at one point or another. That's fine. It's like saying, I don't want to take a job because I'm scared I'm going to get fired. But that's all right. You can get another job. You understand, Eric?
Mm-hmm.
Go out there. I know your problem runs much deeper than the 57 seconds we have to address it. So I'm just going to put it in a nutshell and say, don't rape, don't abuse, just get out there and have some relationships. And whatever was done in the past to you, and I'm sure there was plenty done, see if you can step aside of that wreckage and just enjoy yourself and have a relationship. All right?
Pretty tough.
Yeah, but you know what? Ben said about the prostitute, I think that's worth a try because sometimes you get one under your belt and you build confidence.
I think that's true, too.
Right.
And it no longer
if you're like Ben, you get one under the belt and one on the yarmulke.
there's a certain amount of feeling that there's this bridge to be crossed having sex, and once you've crossed it, then maybe it won't all seem so frightening to you.
Right. All right. And the bridge is not a bad place to meet him either. We'll be back.
Love Line on 92.1
KFMA. Hey, it's a Love Line. All right, we're far out of time. Ben Stein, Jimmy Kimmel, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Win Ben Stein's money. 7:30 and 11:30 every night, Monday through Friday, Comedy Central. Much, much more success to both of you. And if we don't talk again, well, we'll see you. Yeah. We'll see you soon.
All right. Thank
Richard you. Branson from Virgin fame will be in here tomorrow night. Until then, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew. Say mahalo.
Mommy! This has been Loveline. The views expressed on Loveline are not necessarily those of